Morning. I'm Josh McKelvin. No big surprise to find out that Senator Marco Rubio was thinking about a presidential run last year, but now it's this year. We're less than 12 months away from the primary, and he's back in New Hampshire and also drawing big crowds, perhaps picking up the early support that's critical to success in the Granite State. Senator, good to see you. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Drawing a good crowd.
Yeah, a lot of fun.
Yeah, I mean, you've already said that you're make up your mind by spring, I think, on a presidential run. But as we sit here now in February, do you believe, I'm going to get right to it, do you believe you are ready to be president of the
United
States?
Absolutely. Now do I believe I'm ready. I think this country needs to make a turn of the page choice in 2016. The 20th century is a great time. It was the American century. The 21st century has an opportunity to be the American century as well. But we have to leave the past behind and move forward and embrace both the challenges and the opportunities of our time. And we've got some real challenges. There's no doubt about it. And they're significant and they need to be confronted. But if we confront those challenges and embrace the opportunities that the 21st century economy creates and provides, I think our children are going to be the most prosperous Americans that have ever lived. That's the exciting chance before us. We need someone who understands that and knows how to get us there. And if I decide to run for president, I believe I can do that.
Yeah, a lot of people that I talk to, Republicans here in New Hampshire, say, you know what? I really want to see a governor as the next president, has that executive experience. Last president was a senator. When they talk to you and they express those concerns, what do you say?
Well, a couple points. I think we have very talented governors and we're going to make very good candidates. But the job of the president ultimately is to draw a vision for America's future and then show the American people how we're going to get there and then lead us in that direction. And I think the predominant responsibility of the federal government is to keep us safe, to deal with foreign policy issues and national security issues. And I'm very comfortable having that debate with anyone, no matter what their background might have been on as a governor or other. So again, I think we are very talented. We have a very talented pool of Republican potential candidates. And if I decide to run, I think we're going to have a great spirited debate and the Republican voters will make that choice.
So for presidential preparation, public service is public service. You don't think there's any real distinction between whether you're a senator, congressman, governor, anything like that?
I think state experience is helpful. I served in the state legislature for 9 years. I was the Speaker of the House for two of those years, and that's certainly been helpful to me because one of the things that you want from our president is someone who understands that ultimately the majority of our governmental decisions should be made at the state and local level, someone who's done that and has experience and respect for that, and I certainly do.
You obviously bring a resume that might surprise a lot of people here in New Hampshire, given your youthful look, early 40s, but Speaker of the House and part of the legislature, U.S. Senate. When people approach you and they ask about your experience and looking forward, particularly the older voter here in New Hampshire, everybody's engaged. How do you make the case to them that, you know what, despite how I look, you know, I am ready to pick up the mantle and run and turn the page?
Well, a lot of people don't know about what I've done up to this point. Obviously, I was a land use and zoning attorney, and it was up until I got elected to the Senate, had a private sector life. But beyond that, I was a city commissioner for a couple years in a small city. Then I served in the state government for 9 years, two of them as speaker, two of them as majority whip, two of them as majority leader. And then now in the Senate for the last 4 years, I've really focused heavily on national security issues, both in my spot on the Intelligence Committee and also on the Foreign Relations Committee. So again, I have a history of making decisions at the national level that provide people some insight into how I make judgments on issues. So I feel comfortable with who I am and what I've done.
But you're okay with the idea of repeating your resume, your early work, because that's what people expect here in New Hampshire, especially, I mean they can read a lot of things in the headlines and see what the national news says, but they're going to start over from scratch with you.
Right.
And you're okay with the process.
Absolutely. Again, look, I'm very proud of a public service I've rendered to this country, starting in the state level, obviously, and at the local level. And those have been experiences that have added to my federal experience. In essence, having an appreciation for the kind of issues you confront at the state level, as we did with Speaker, where we had to balance a $70 billion budget, is the kind of experience that I think will be useful to me, both in the Senate and if I decide to run for president.
All right, let's get to it. Obviously, this week, Congress is taking up the issue of Homeland Security. We'll see what happens there. But, you know, after the last election, I think the voters said, we want a Congress that's going to get something done. I think that was the mandate that a lot of people pointed to. And yet, here we are, down at 11th hour again, stalemate. What's, you know, how has anything changed? You're a member of this Congress.
Right. Well, a couple points. Obviously, the president still is the president and can veto anything we pass unless it has 68 votes. And the filibuster is still in place, and Democrats can filibuster. And that's what they've done consistently on DHS. They have refused to even allow the debate to begin. Now, one of the things we'd like to see done, in addition to funding the Department of Homeland Security, is to stop the president's unconstitutional executive action that he took last year. It's an executive action that he himself, on 22 different occasions, admitted he did not have the power to do. And that, as a result, has violated our Constitution, but has also created some unintended consequences of it. For example, I think you could have another mass migration as a result of this, people coming here believing they can stay in this country if they come in illegally, and also the fact that it's going to make it harder to achieve meaningful reform of the kinds we need legislatively in immigration.
You know, when you and you just to be clear, the executive order you're talking about was related to the immigration last year.
Yeah, he basically has said he's not going to enforce the immigration laws when it comes to 6 million people that have been in this country illegally for a decade or longer. Ultimately, I think we need to deal with that.
Sure.
But I think we need to deal with that in law, not in executive orders.
But in terms of homeland security and national security and public safety, there's a funding issue going on right now.
Right.
And whether you believe the 6 million people should be here or granted asylum, whatever, that money needs to go to this department so they can either look at the people that are already here or look at the people that are crossing the border,
and
it's not happening.
So as I pointed to people, DHS won't shut down. Its vital services, most of which are considered vital, will continue to function. It'll be a problem, certainly, because the individuals that work at DHS will not get paid during this period of time, and it creates all sorts of problems for them that we shouldn't take lightly. But we're not the ones that are trying to shut down DHS. It's
sure.
The Democrats who continue to filibuster the solution.
But I want to point out that, yeah, DHS will be open, but from the way I understand it, it won't be proactive. I mean, you can go there, but the activities will be limited.
TSA agents will still be working. Border Patrol will still be working. Again, it's not the ideal situation. We have to fund it at some point. But I think what we really need to be asking is, why do the Democrats not even allow a debate on how we fund it?
Let's talk about ISIS. This is something you've been asked about a lot during your trip to New Hampshire here, and you're very pointed about it. If you were president, and I know you hate to hypothesize, politicians do, but if you were president, 22 Christians are beheaded. What's your immediate reaction?
Well, my immediate reaction actually is the reaction I've had since late last year when ISIS first emerged, and that is, first, I don't think the president needs congressional authority, but if he seeks it should be congressional authority to defeat ISIS, period. Nothing about time constraints or geographic constraints. Then I would create and put in place a military tactic strategy that could work. And in my mind, that is increased air support in combination with a local army made up of Egyptian soldiers, Jordanian soldiers, soldiers from Gulf kingdoms, the Kurds, the Sunnis in Iraq, the Turks. Put together a ground force of over 100,000 soldiers from those countries with U.S. air support, U.S. intelligence and logistical support, and some U.S. special operations forces to go in on the ground and defeat ISIS on the ground in Iraq and Syria.
If that sounds great, but coalition building is something that a lot of people have been talking about for a long time now, and it hasn't been able to
be
accomplished.
To be honest, the president hasn't put effort in trying it. For example, the Egyptians a week ago took airstrikes in Libya, and the White House refuses to say they support those airstrikes. I think they have to make a commitment, and they have to lead from not from behind, but from the front on putting together that coalition. Without American leadership, that coalition's not going to happen.
So to be clear, boots on the ground is something you support, but only in the context of a group effort.
Well, I support whatever it takes to defeat ISIS. I think the better way of defeating them is with local forces. They have more skin in the game. They're more immediately impacted. I think they would have more success on the ground in dealing with local populations as they address this issue. I think U.S. air support, increased U.S. air support, will be critical to the success of that kind of mission. I think U.S. logistical and intelligence support as well, but ultimately, and I think it may require some special operations forces on the ground on behalf of the United States, but I think the brunt of it should be borne by those local governments that are most immediately impacted and who, quite frankly, want to do this. The Egyptians have been calling for this. The Jordanians have been calling for this. Now what it takes is U.S. leadership to bring together that coalition to defeat not just ISIS, but al-Nusra and any of these other radical groups that are threatening stability.
All right, let's talk about a couple other topical issues that have made its way into the race recently. Talking about vaccinations of children and whether they should be mandatory. What's your position when you talk about
children should be vaccinated? Now, obviously, there are children that are immune suppressed that can't be, and there are young infants that aren't, and that's the reason why all children should be vaccinated, because that protects them, and it protects that disease from spreading into an unvaccinated infant or into a child who is receiving cancer treatment and so perhaps is not fully immunized. All my children are vaccinated. I think that many schools across the country require those vaccines. And we have eradicated in this country things like polio, that, for example, that crippled my grandfather when he was 6 years old and left him disabled for the rest of his life. It would be a tragedy now in the 21st century to go backwards on these advances.
So, yeah, so mandatory with health exceptions.
Obviously, sure. I mean, there's some kids that can't be vaccinated, but they're the reason why you want everyone else to be vaccinated. Because if a child is immune suppressed and cannot be vaccinated, you want to make sure that every other child in a school is. Therefore, they do not become carriers for that disease that could ultimately impact him or her.
Okay, let me ask you about climate change now. Obviously, you come from a very different climate than we experience up here. We're going through quite a winter, but the debate still rages. How much do you think that climate change, global warming, however you want to characterize it, should be a major issue or an issue at all in the 2016 race?
Well, first of all, it's understanding climate's always changing. The fundamental question is not whether there's climate change. The fundamental question is what percentage of it, how much of that is due to human activity? And the sensitivity of the climate is something that there is no scientific consensus on. There might be a consensus among scientists that humans are contributing to it, but how much, there is no consensus on. And beyond that, we're being asked as policymakers to make decisions on policy changes people want made that would be devastating to our economy. So in essence, policy changes, many of whom would have no impact whatsoever on the climate, but would have devastating impacts on destroying jobs, making life more expensive for working Americans. So I can't support policies that are going to destroy our economy in exchange for scientific benefits no one can define.
So, well, let me ask you, I mean, do you believe that we are contributing in a meaningful way to what we're experiencing?
We don't know. There really is no scientific consensus on how sensitive the climate is. And in fact, many of the models that scientists have been talking about to justify positions taken by policymakers have not borne out.
So you're not convinced that anything that we do or don't do, either way, has an impact on
the climate? I'm not convinced that in the cost-benefit analysis, what they are asking us to do, the benefits of it outweigh the devastating costs. In fact, I'm increasingly convinced that many of the policy changes they're asking us to make will make life more expensive for the average American, will destroy jobs, will hurt us economically, and in exchange for it, not even its proponents can tell us or will tell us what measurable impact it'll have on climate or the environment.
Okay, let's move forward. Obviously, this is going to be a debate that we have throughout this campaign. Let's talk about the field. Now, a part of it. Let's go back to December when Governor Jeb Bush said that he was seriously, actively considering a presidential run. You're both from Florida. Did that have any impact at that moment on your decision making, and how did you kind of think about that moving forward?
No. Look, Jeb Bush is going to be a quality candidate. Works very hard. He's very intelligent. He's going to have a tremendous network of support, and he's going to raise a lot of money. But I think if you decide the best place to serve your country is from the presidency, you run irrespective of who else might be in the race. And he would tell you the exact same thing. So I have tremendous admiration and respect for him, but I need to decide where the right place for me to serve is. And if I run, it won't be against Jeb Bush. It'll be because I believe I'm the best person for the job at this time in our history.
And how close are you to believing that?
Well, we have to make a final decision here in the spring, I believe.
Sure.
So we're getting closer to that date. Obviously, it's not this week, but we're getting closer to making that decision. In the meantime, I think what's informing my decision is the reception we're getting and the conversations we're having with voters as we visit these states that are going to be critical to that process.
Expect to see you back sometime soon?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. Senator Marco Rubio, great
Thank
to see you.
Thanks
for
Thank
joining.